So that's what I'm referring to as harmony amongst your referral partners.
Can you hold for 1 second?
Valencia?
What CRM?
I'm about to get to that.
Oh.
Give us a second. We're not there yet.
Okay.
All right, we're going to move on to some of the best practices. There are so many best practices for networking, so we're just going to touch on a teeny few of them. One of them is your introduction, which is known as your elevator speech or your infomercial. And I know that as networkers, we know these things, but just kind of check with yourself when you do your infomercial. Have you ever seen anyone get up and actually stop breathing? I am this with my company, and you know, they're like so rigid. You want to breathe. And also, you look at people that are giving their infomercials, and it's, hi, I'm Linda McCabe, I'm with Optimal Level, it's a, you know, dead. You want to smile. You want to make sure that your tone is right, that you're not talking too loud. Have you ever seen somebody get up in an event, and you kind of talk like this, and you're going, what? So you want to make sure that their tone is right, you're not going too fast. In one of my chambers that talks very slow. You're going to find yourself falling asleep. So it's not going to do you good, so watch those things. Best practice for networkers is something called a referral profile form. How many of you are familiar with that? Oh, because you're an Optimal Level and you must have told her. it's not a brochure and it's not actually your business materials. It's a document that aids your good networking partners for what to look for, what to listen to, and if they find somebody that's interesting, how to refer you. So we're going to have information about our email, and there's contact information. If you want to know and see an example of a referral profile form, let me know, and I'll make sure to email one to you. The last thing is, Judy and I have been in sales for many, 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 many years, and it just amazes me. Everybody is selling. You know, whatever you're doing, somehow you're selling. And if you meet somebody that might know somebody that might know somebody, that's a prospect or whatever, why don't people follow up? I've known people that have stacks and stacks of cards, and then they come to me and they say, I have all these cards, I don't know what to do. So you want to make sure that you qualify your cards. I met this person, and I don't think there's a great connection. You know, I might send them something sometime. I'm going to put them in this pile. I met this person, I'm so excited because I know that I can introduce them to so-and-so. So qualify the business cards when you get back and then put them. She's going to talk to you about a CRM.
I'm going to talk to you about that knee-high boot box full of business cards you got under your desk. So a CRM is a client relationship management system. It's a piece of software. Now, when you can buy it from a million different sources, and for those of you that are like, how on earth do I even begin to walk up that path? On the back, in the back form, if you fill out the form and make sure that I get it, I will send you a 2011 CRM cloud-based comparison so you can see all of the benefits and the costs and what everything does, and it can make a monochrome sense, and then I can answer questions that you have. What this system does is it allows you to predetermine every single follow-up step that you have for your verticals, for your sales processes, so that everything becomes delegatable. Any solopreneurs out there dream of delegating something someday? It can happen, it's true. They've got to be delegatable, duplicatable, and automatable. If you are responsible for every single piece of follow-up that ever happens in your business, you will become overwhelmed. And what that does is it causes you to procrastinate. So imagine you're walking into your office and you've been to a networking event and you've got your 25, 30 cards, and each one of them has a qualification, A, B, C, or D, according to, are they a hot prospect? Are they a potential strategic partner? Are they just a networking buddy, or is it, I'll put you in my database and we'll figure out what happens? And each one of those has a system that follows up with it, whether it goes onto your assistant's desk or it pops up and reminds you, hey, make a phone call, this person kind of rocked, it'll pay off. You no longer have to keep it up here. So it becomes a process that supports you without you having to be in control of everything, and it quiets that white noise that the business owner has of where's my next buck coming from, where's my next lead supposed to be, and I know I've been slap busy, where's all the business? It'll also allow you to really create some project management as well, so that you can start to reduce the time and the repetitiveness in your company. So it's going to show up as a general piece of software, and then you go back and do the modifications that make sense for you and your business. If anybody wants to talk to me about that, I am a CRM geek, and I get really excited, and I will geek all over you and share with you all of my CRM enthusiasm. But be prepared, you may want a cocktail.
Please turn to page 3 in your workbook.
And I'm going to hit this quote for you because it's not in your it's not in your guide. And it's a quote by Gandhi. And it says, men or women often become what they believe themselves to be. If I believe I cannot do something, it makes me incapable of doing it. But when I believe I can, then I acquire the ability to do it even if I didn't have it in the beginning. Sum it up. If you believe you can or you believe you can't, you're right.
Thank you. I'm going to ask you 2 questions. I'd just like to see a show of hands, please. How many of you really like salespeople that are selling to you? A few. Okay, not surprising. Do you feel resistance when you sell? More hands. Okay, that makes sense. Now I'm going to ask you to answer something for me. Can you identify why the concept of selling is so challenging to you personally? Why do you think it's so challenging to you, the concept of selling? Yes, please. There's judgment involved. Who you are when you do that, right? Okay, excellent. I want to talk to you about acceptance and belief. And I think this is the most important part. That's a big statement I'm making. I think this is the most important part that has to do with whether or not you succeed in selling. I know there's a lot of stages of selling, but I'm going to focus on 2 of them. One of them is a snake oil salesman who used to come into a town and make a big, loud noise, lots of bright lights, everything to get attention, and all the townspeople would come out, and they'd be entertained, and they'd be excited, and he would hold up a tonic that not only prevented baldness, cured diarrhea, you know, could make you a millionaire, whatever it is, and all these people would get all excited, and they would purchase this product. It was a big deal. But when this guy rolled out of town, what happened is people got bald, they had diarrhea, and they didn't get rich. So there was a concept that was developed that salespeople aren't telling the truth, that they're conning you. They're just making you believe something that isn't true. Now I'm going to fast forward to when I got involved in selling, which is in 1980. And the system then that was very popular, contrary to today, was companies would hire representatives. And the representatives would go into another company and they would sell their product. How? Features and benefits. And I can't tell you how many people I threw out of my office who came in front of me to sell something, opened their notebook, and told me how fantastically terrific they were. Who wants to hear that? Okay, so the concept of selling went from somebody who's not telling the truth to somebody who's just saying they're great and they're not thinking at all about who you are and what you need. I love selling. Why do I love it? Part of it is the game. There's no question. It's fun for me. But what I love about it is it's collaborative. Those people that know me know I don't do a thing by myself. I always ask for everybody to help me. I believe in collaboration. When I get in front of a person, I want to know everything I can about that person, because if I have an opportunity to help, is there any greater feeling than to help somebody? We all get off on helping people. It's a great joy. So to be able to sit in front of somebody and ask them questions and find out, what do you need? What do you want? How can I help you? And then be able to put that information together with what you've got. You've got the solution. That's what selling is all about. If you come to what you're doing as an experience, thinking I'm forcing somebody, I'm asking them for something, I'm making them do something, you are cutting off your legs, just creating a situation where before you even get started, it's over. Love what you do if you sell, because you are a person that cares about somebody else and you're helping them. The other thing is that I think people have a hard time with is belief. So now I love what I'm doing. I think selling is the greatest thing. I'm really happy to do it, but I'm not good at it. I'm really not good at it. How many of you secretly hold that in your mind? I don't know how. I don't believe I'll be successful. I often tell people in Optimal Level that we have a little drill there sitting on the table. Pick up the drill, drill this hole in your head, stick your hand inside of it, and take that thought, pull it out of there, and throw it as far as you can, try to get it to Mars or the moon. Because you have to believe in yourself if you're going to be successful at sales. Okie doke. I'd like you, on page 3, to write down what you've experienced, what are your greatest challenges and barriers to creating sales and acceptance and belief. Just think about that for yourself. What are your greatest challenges for accepting and belief in what you do? So first write that down for about a minute or two, and then we're going to share some of those answers.
So who has one of those answers ready that they wouldn't mind sharing? Oh, don't make me pick on people.
I don't like being sold, so therefore when I'm trying to sell, I'm thinking I'm that person that I don't like.
That's great.
And to that extent, when people are trying to sell me, I'm like, enough fluff, just get to your point and quit beating around the bush. And I know they're just trying to, you know, get me to like them and stuff. And I know that in sales, you know, get a rapport, you know, and I'm like, this is why I'm calling, this is what it's about, and I know that doesn't work.
Shannon, do you feel that at times, even though your intentions are good, you feel disingenuous because how others have sold to you?
No.
Okay.
I don't feel I get to, I get to the point, and again, it's because that's what I want, and not everybody is me.
Okay. All right. Very good. Thank you.
But most importantly, I don't like it.
Well, I think that goes to a very important sales technique, which is called mirroring. And mirroring is a neuro-linguistic programming, kind of a baseline, where you speak at the speed of the person that you're speaking to. If they're very quick, and you're taking your time and talking about your kids, they're done. Like, they want to be out of there 15 minutes ago. Meanwhile, if you're nailing them between the eyes, and they're sitting there just glued to the wall going, oh my, I don't realize what I signed up for, you got to pull it back a little bit, because it's not about your comfort.
Yeah.
It's about their comfort. Mm-hmm. And when you match their physicality and their speech pattern, they automatically, on a subconscious level, feel that they are on the same level that you are, even if you're thinking 20 minutes ahead of where you're actually at. This is not an easy exercise, and I don't want it to appear that way. So we're going to give you a little bit of an example of where we came through. And Linda, when we were going through this process Optimal Level, what we came up with is Optimal Level serves as a catalyst to develop the clarity, balance, power, and results that launches the growth of professional careers and companies.